Take your cell phones out and text this to 22300. 22300. And text alert to that number.
Text what? Alert?
Alert. Yeah. Alert.
22300.
22300. And that will help you to get all the alerts from the church and everything else you need to know what's going on. Alright? Hey, Dawn's going to lead us in a song. So y'all can stand and worship to the good Lord. Amen.
Well, good evening.
Good evening.
Oh, I had a response. I teach virtually, so I say, hey, and they're like, I know you can talk to me. Wants us to be, and so I think it's just
back up. I don't want to spit on nobody. It's COVID season. My goal for you for the rest of this year is to swim in God's love. So I'm going to try to help with that, try to point you to God's word, because I know that if we don't swim in God's love, you're just going to be burned out. Most likely, you're going to throw in the towel at some point if you're not swimming in God's love.
Amen.
All right? And so I'm going to read verses on Wednesday nights and do like a mini, like 2 to 5 minute devotion and just point you to God's love. And so for tonight, I'm going to take you to Exodus chapter 33. If you want to turn there, you can. Exodus chapter 33, verse 6. Exodus chapter 34, verse 6. 34. Talks about it in 33, too. 34, verse 6. And the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord. This is what the Lord says to Moses. God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, by no means clearing the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and the children's children to the third and what?
Fourth generation.
And so let me remind you, God, the Lord, tells Moses this shortly after he delivers the people out of Israel. And then what do they start doing? Grumbling and complaining right after they saw the goodness of God. Right? Sounds like me. Right? And so God, we know the story. About 40 years prior to this, he delivers his people. He overthrows Pharaoh and Egypt. He shows the enemy that you cannot override my love for my people, right? And if you're taking notes, write this down. The Lord can override any enemy to get his love to you, including you, right? He can override your flesh. He can override any human being. He will do whatever he can to show you how much he loves you. Now, it's up to you to respond, right? And so this God, listen to this. He's not looking for you to perform perfectly, because you can't, right? Your title, your performance should not give you this access to try to outplay God. What do I mean by that? Sometimes we're trying to put on this performance. Sometimes we're trying to live out this perfect life that we cannot live out. Sometimes we're trying to just earn the love of God, and you can't, right? No performance, no title, no status upon your name can make God love you even more or even less. His love is perfect for you right now. And I don't know about you, like, I'm thankful my God just chases after sinners like you and me. And even when you continue to mess up, he continues to chase you down. Why? Because he loves you. Right? Read the verse again. Verse 6. And the Lord passed before him and proclaimed. This is the Lord speaking. The Lord, God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth. He says this to people that have been rebelling against him for 40 years. Amen? Listen to this. Your rebelliousness does not take God's love away from you, but it should drive you back to his love. Amen? And so I'm telling you this so that we can learn this. Quit trying to earn back God's love for your soul. Because a lot of times we get saved, we make messes, and then we try to build ourselves back up to God's love. You can't do it. He just loves you. Amen? That should take a lot of weight off you tonight. Quit trying to get back to God's love. He already loves you. You just have to recognize it. And so, love God, love others. Word? But you can't love God and love others unless you become more aware of God's love. Becoming more aware of God's love will help you to love God and love others like we should. And so what I want you to see tonight, even after the people rebel against him for 40 years, he continues to come after them. Amen. His love is unconditional upon his people. So if you're going to be aware of God's love, be aware it's unconditional. It's not based on your performance. It's not based on you climbing back up the ladder whenever you mess up. It's based on you coming to a loving God that will clean you up and help you along the journey. Word?
Word.
And remember that for Sunday. All right? I'm going to go more into depth Sunday. Let's pray, church. Father, many brothers and sisters, maybe even in this room, God, I know for me, for my own journey, when I've messed up, God, I'm always trying to climb the ladder to get back to you. The good news is I don't have to climb a ladder. God, you're just here for us. You're here, God, and God, you have to make us aware of you being here and you just opening up your arms to sinners. Father, show my brothers and sisters to quit trying to work for your love and just receive your love and be aware of your love. And Father, we just thank you that your love is rooted throughout the Old Testament. And Father, we need to know that if we're going to understand the New Testament when they talk about your love. In Jesus' name, amen. You remember this past Sunday, I was telling you out of Romans that nothing can separate you from God's love. You remember that? And so where Paul is getting that from is the Old Testament, right? No power, no demonic force. No matter how powerful the human being is, nobody, no one, no created thing can separate you from God's love. And the question you have to ask yourself is, where does Paul get that from? Genesis, right? Exodus 34. Right? 1st, 2nd Samuel, 1st, 2nd Kings, Jeremiah, Isaiah, nothing can separate God's love from his people. Heshed, everybody say Heshed. Everybody say psh. Alright. Heshed. That's the word for love throughout the Old Testament, and it means loyalty. God is loyal to his people even when they mess up. Amen? That's the good news about the gospel. Even when we're unloyal, he stays loyal. Amen. He wants to love us tonight, church. Swimming is love. Amen?
Amen.
I promise you, if you start swimming in God's love, you'll tell a difference in your own personal life and family and church life. You can't love God and love others unless you understand his love is unconditional. Amen?
Amen.
So prayer. Everybody say prayer.
Prayer.
So we're kind of going a new route tonight with prayer. So let me trace back. About a month ago, I encouraged you to pray even in the busyness of life. If you're too busy to pray, you're too busy. Amen? You have to find time to pray even in the busyness of life. And then the past 2 weeks, we've been talking about praying when unfortunate events take place, right? We know Jesus was rejected by his own family, community. He goes to prayer. We know Jesus' best friend, John the Baptist, was beheaded. He goes to prayer. Amen? And so tonight, I know this can be kind of first grade, but I think we forget it. So if you're taking notes, write this down. We must pray after a powerful work of God. We must pray after a powerful work of God. Have you been in church long enough? Whenever God starts saving people, when God starts working in a church, we think it's okay to stop praying. Amen? Have y'all been in those services, man, where God saves? You have what we call a great revival, and people are getting baptized, and then everybody thinks it's okay to stop praying. It's not. That's the time to pray even more, right? Because we know when God works in a powerful way, there's an enemy coming.
Amen.
To come try to uproot what God just did. Word?
Word?
And so when God works, that's not a time to stop praying. Word? The temptation is to quit praying because God just saved multiple people, right? We've done our job, Stephen, right? We've done our job, right? We've prayed. Didn't y'all see how God worked in the service that morning? Don't you see how God just saved a bunch of people? We don't got to pray anymore. God heard our prayers. No, we continue to pray.
Amen.
That's what's hurting a lot of churches. God works and we just quit praying, right? We quit meeting and praying for sake of brothers and sisters and for the sake of the lost. We just quit praying. Word?
Word.
And so I'm going to take you to Mark tonight, back in Mark chapter 6. And hopefully give you some encouragement. Anybody need some encouragement? Mark chapter 6. We're going to look at verses 30 through 47 real quick. All right, so here's the big idea. What's the big idea? Somebody talk to me. What's the big idea? We pray after a what happens?
Powerful word.
How many of you were here that Sunday before we got hit with COVID? That second service specifically. How many of you were here? I mean, what a powerful word. Y'all remember that service? I mean, God, I mean, I walked in here and there's people already at the altar praying. I was like, wow, right? Between services, we were actually upstairs, a group of us praying, right? That was a powerful service. Wouldn't you agree? And then right after that, guess what happens? Unfortunate events. I think God knew we were probably in Mark 6. And that's the thing about following Jesus. Whenever, you know, we're going through a book or whenever we're learning stuff, God's going to test us. And he's tested us, church. Powerful work takes place. Unfortunate events take place. And guess what we must continue to do? Right? And so tonight we're going to look at the powerful experience, the powerful work that Christ did in Mark. And then right after he does that work, he gets in prayer. All right? So if you're taking notes, I'm going to kind of hopefully help some of you out tonight. You need rest. Can anybody testify?
Amen.
You need rest. Look at verse 30 through 33 with me real quick. Then the apostles gathered Jesus and told him all the things, both what they had done and what they had taught. They're busy, right? Their own mission, their teaching. And if any of you have ever done any teaching, you know that can drain you. Word? Any teachers in the room? All right, amen. That can drain you, man. Look at verse 31. And he said to them, come aside by yourselves to a deserted place and what?
Rest.
Y'all get some rest. Everybody say rest.
Rest.
Can't you use some rest? And I'm talking about rest from ministry. Right? Some of you are so busy and you haven't rested in the last 2 years, and that's why you're drained. Right? If you're in ministry, or if you're just in life in general, like, you just need to rest. Word? Take a break. Amen. And don't ever go camping with Mitchell. It won't be good. Look at the rest of verse 31. For there were many coming and going, and they did not even have time to eat. You hear that? Disciples don't even got time to eat right now. Life's just busy. Verse 32, so they departed to a deserted place in the boat by themselves, but the multitude saw them departing, and many knew him and ran their own foot from all the cities that arrived before them and came together to him. So if you're taking notes, write this down. Rest, meaning you getting away. If it's for a weekend, if it's for a week, you need to get away from ministry. Amen. You need to get away, if you can, from the busyness of life. Amen.
Amen.
Christ says, y'all go rest. Amen. Did y'all know God rested even before the fall? Rest is not a result of the fall. Rest gets your heart in tune with God. Spiritual rest, right? You put everything to the side. Busyness, ministry, work, right? You're just going to rest with the Lord. How do you rest with the Lord? For me, I just take out my Bible, take out my journal, and say, you know what? I'm putting Facebook to the side. I'm putting social media to the side. I'm going to detox, and I'm going to just get along with God. For some of us, maybe it's a day you just getting away from ministry and resting. Word?
Word.
Listen to this. If you're never resting from the busyness of ministry and life, you will burn out. You will burn out. Amen. Many pastors resign because they think they're Superman. Many pastors aren't in ministry anymore. Even many members aren't in ministry no more because they try to do everything. Right? They think they have to be at every meeting. They think they have to be at every church function. And they never take time to just say, you know what, Pastor Steve? My wife and I, we're going off to the mountains. Love you, bro. See you next week. Amen, Mitchell. Right? Listen, if Jesus rested, and he did, who are you and me not to rest and to get away from ministry and life itself? Word? Listen, if you don't get rest, you could become blinded to God's word because you are so tired. Mentally, emotionally, spiritually, and everything else underneath. A lot of people can't see the work of God because they're tired. Amen? Like, have you seen, like, you ever seen, like, a movement of God in a service, and somebody look at you and said, I didn't get nothing out of that? You know why? They're probably tired. Word? Maybe that's been you. I know that's been me. Right? Look what Jesus says. Verse 31. He said to them, come aside by yourselves to a deserted place and what? Rest a while. Now we're about to see there's a disruption here. Amen. You ever know you needed rested? You needed rest and disruption just came. Word? So listen to this. I would encourage all leaders to rest from ministry. If you have any kind of leadership role, or if you're even involved in ministry, you need to take a break at some point. Quit trying to be Superman. Quit trying to be Superwoman. Word? I would encourage everybody that's always doing something, take a week off at some point. I would say every 4 months, take a week off. Word? For some of us. I'm not talking about work. I'm talking about ministry. Get away from the church for a little bit. Word? Now, this will be hard for you to do if you think your presence is needed for God to work. Take that in. Your presence, and I say this in love, my presence is not needed for God to work here. Amen. God was working before you existed, brother, sister. Right? Because somebody have this, a lot of people have this mindset of ministry, like, I have to be there in order for God to work. No, you don't.
Amen.
Right? God spoke this word into existence way before we had existence. Amen. You need to go rest. Right?
Word?
Find time to rest. It's okay to get away. Well, what's going to happen if I'm not here and we don't have anybody to do my role? Guess what? You don't have, nobody needs to do that role that Sunday or that Wednesday. Just go get a break. We don't have lyrics on the screen. Oh, well. If that's going to save your soul from being burned out and ultimately falling in sin, go take a break. Amen. You want to know why many members leave? A lot of times they're just burned out. Why? Because they thought they had to be there. God said, just go rest a while. Word?
Word.
If you're feeling burned out tonight, you need to do what Jesus told you to do. Go rest a while. Go take a break. Maybe for you that's a day. Maybe for you that's a weekend. Maybe for you that's a week. Hopefully it's not a month or a year. Word? So you need to go take a break. Right?
Amen.
Listen to this statement. Rest helps you to see that you're not in control. Do any of y'all struggle with control, man? You just want to be in control. I think all of us, if we're honest with ourselves, by nature, we want control. Right? Some of us think it can't happen the way it needs to happen unless we're there. Anybody struggle with that? Rest will show you, listen, you're not in control. God is. And he can work in your absence or in your presence. But you need to remember, church, you're human. And you need some rest. So there is a disruption here. If you take notes, write this down. Two, you need to be sensitive to God's voice. Verse 34 through 44. And Jesus, when he came out, saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion for them because they were like sheep, not having a shepherd. So he began to teach them many things. When the day was now far spent, his disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and already the hour is late." Like, Jesus, can you quit teaching? I'm tired. You ever felt that way? God's doing a work, man, and you're just tired. Amen? God wants us to show compassion to people. And sometimes it's just like, Lord, can I do it tomorrow? Have you ever been like somebody asked you to go out to eat and you're just like, man, I'm tired, but you hear God tell you, go show compassion. Word? You're tired. But God wants you to just pause for a moment. Go listen to this. Go show compassion and then you can take a break. Amen? Keep on reading. What verse are we in? 36. Send them away, and they may go into the surrounding country and villages and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat. But he answered and said to them, "You give them something to eat." We're tired, Jesus. He says, so? Right. So hopefully you're seeing the tension here. All right, we're going to go through that tension here. All right? Sometimes we're tired, but sometimes God still wants us to spend just a little, another hour or two showing compassion. Because you never know whose life you can change within that 30 minutes to an hour to 2 hours, even though you're tired. Right? Some of my most powerful experiences in the ministry so far in 8 years is this. I'm tired, but God's put somebody in my path to just speak a word to. Word? You never know, that word could change a life. Right? That person can be on their way to commit suicide. Amen. Smoke some dope. Right? You never know what people are going through. Amen?
Amen.
And I know we're tired. Word?
Word?
But God sometimes says, just slow down and feed somebody. Word? Slow down and encourage somebody. Right? I know you're tired, but give me another hour. Right? It's been a long day for some of us, right? You're tired. Word? But God can speak a word to encourage you in this hour. Word? Verse 37, give them something to eat. And they said to him, "Shall we go and buy 200 denarii worth of bread and give them something to eat?" Here comes the power. 38, but he said to them, "How many loaves do you have? Go and see." And when they found out that they had 5 and 2 fish, then he, Jesus, commanded them to make them all sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat down in ranks, in hundreds and in fifties. When he had taken the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven, blessed, and broke the loaves and gave them to his disciples to set before them. And 2 fish he divided among them all. So they all ate and were filled. And they took up 12 baskets full of fragments and of fish. Now those who had eaten the loaves were about what? So if you're taking notes, write this down. Sometimes the Lord will say, give me a few more hours in your weakness in order to show you his power. Right? Sometimes the Lord will say, give me 30 more minutes. Give me another hour. Give me 2 hours because I'm about to show you my power. Word? Maybe that's you tonight. I mean, I don't know about you. There's sometimes I'm just like, Lord, I'm tired and I just need to see your supernatural power. Word? Just need God to just drop down his power and just work in, right, our relationships with each other, work in our conversations with people at Highway 55 or wherever you go. I just need to see God at work. And sometimes God says, listen, you go get rest, but you just pause and give me another hour or two because I'm about to show you my power. And then you can go get your rest. Right? So for some of you, maybe it's at work, man. You're just tired. But then God wants to do something right there in your weariness that could change your life. Because right? I don't know about you, that probably changed the lives of about 5,000 people. Right? Seeing that miracle of Jesus, and we know that Jesus ultimately does this to point them to him.
Amen.
That he is the one that gives living water, right? Living food, spiritually speaking. He is the one that gives salvation and rest for the soul. Right? But at the same time, we need to rest. You're going to get burned out if you try to be everywhere all the time. Amen. Music people, teachers, quit trying to do it all. Let Jesus say, go rest a while. Take a day. Take a weekend. Take a week. And just go get refreshed so you can see God's power once again. And now I know that's hard for some of us because we want to be everywhere. Amen? We want people to know I'm here. I'm here every week. Word, I'm here at every practice. I'm here at every lesson. And God's just saying, listen, you need to go rest a while. Word? You just need to go take a break. Listen to this. If you take a break too quickly, though, you may miss what God wants you to see. And so how do we, like, fix this tension? Christ says go rest a while, but then he tells them, hey, y'all just wait a few more moments. I want to show you my power. How do we fix this tension? Right? And here's what I got for you. That just depends on your intimacy with God. Word? Like, God is a God that's walking with his people. He's a God that wants to have intimacy with you. So how do you fix this tension where, like, you know you need a break, but God's just saying, hey, wait just a few more moments because I want to show you my power. How do you fix this tension? You have intimacy with him. Right? Because trust me, God will let you know when it's time to go take a break. And God will let you know, just hang on a few more hours. God will let you know. Question is, are you walking that close to God where you can hear him in such a way? Right? I don't know about you, the disciples here, they're just ready to go to sleep. They're just like, Lord, send them elsewhere, man. Send them to Chatham. Send them to Fair Bluff. Just send them somewhere else. And he says, no, I got to work for y'all. I'm ultimately show you my power, and then you can go take a nap. So my encouragement, here's four applications, and then we're done. You may be tired because of ministry. That can be a time for God to show you his power and provision for your life. That looks different for all of us. Right? Questioning, I'm asking you all tonight, is God telling you to take a break? If so, listen to him. Word? Hey, I'll just say this. If we learn how to take breaks and rest here at Peace, all of us, we'll probably last a little longer. We'll all be here a decade later. Word? A lot of people are leaving because they just didn't take a break. Amen? 4 or 5 years at the same church, you'll get burned out if you don't take a break. You have church hoppers, listen to this, because they didn't take a break. They didn't keep their soul healthy. Amen? Yeah. 10 years from now, I believe this room can be filled for God's glory. But it's going to take the people we have now, the core group, listen to this, to take a break and keep your soul healthy. Yeah. Amen? Yeah. 2, stay in prayer when the Lord shows you his power. I'm about to show you that. In verse 46. Take a break from ministry. Number 3, take a break from ministry. Get refreshed. It'll help you to stay in the race. 4, God has called you to rest weekly. Y'all know that? He's called you to get away from reality and just get in tune with him. Amen? And again, I know life can be busy and maybe we say we can't do that, but you can. You can. Amen? Because if God tells you to do it, you got to do it. You just got to find time to do it. Word? And maybe for you, maybe it's just the first 6 hours of your day, man. Just get along with the Lord. Go on a boat. Go to the mountains if you feel like going to. Just go somewhere and get refreshed. I need you a decade from now. But I won't have you if you're not taking breaks. You'll be burned out. Some of you are burned out because you just haven't taken a break. Word? So, Christ, he provides all this bread. Word? For 5,000 people. And then look what he does in verse 46. And when he had sent them away, he departed to the mountain to do what?
Pray.
You see, when God works in a powerful way, we need to get in prayer. Amen? And y'all look at the next few verses. I mean, what is Jesus doing? He's doing something else that's powerful. He's walking on water. Amen? You see, when you get in prayer, listen, it'll prepare your heart for more of his power to come. about you, man. I just want to see God's power. But if we're all tired and weary, emotionally, mentally, spiritually, it's going to be hard for us to see His power because we're going to be so tired. Amen? Like, God's at work all around us right now. I promise you that. I just read something. Let me make sure I'm correct on this. I posted it last night, but I just wanted to make sure I got the number right. 35 people received salvation this past Sunday at a church. God is saving people every week all over the United States. I mean, COVID doesn't stop salvation. It's us. We need to take a break and get re-energized and just get back in tune with what God wants to do. Right? Word? And again, you aren't the Messiah. Take a break. Amen? Like, you are flesh. God wants to use you, but He's also told you to go get some rest. Weekly. But if you keep on and on and on and on and on and on, it's going to be hard for you to stay in tune. Get some rest. Amen?
Amen.
I'll tell anybody on staff, I mean, go get some rest. Every 4 months, take a weekend and just go get some rest. Anybody that's constantly in leadership, in music or whatever, teaching, I mean, go get some rest. Every 4 months, take a weekend off, take your family. I'm not going to be mad. Go get some rest. Go get some refreshment. Life's busy. Work is busy. Ministry on top of that is busy. Go rest your soul. Stay healthy.
Amen.
Word.
Word.
If Jesus rested, I mean, can't you?
Word.
So church, get rest so you can stay healthy. Continue ministry. If you don't, you'll burn out or you'll get caught up in a trap of the devil. Where that trap can be depression, sexual sin, I mean, it can be anything. Isn't it worth keeping your soul healthy, church?
Amen.
Word?
Word.
Angerness? Bitterness, right? Gossip. You see, when you don't rest your soul, there's a greater chance you'll live for the devil.
Amen.
Word. Jesus is trying to get His disciples, man, rest, pray, and get ministry done. Amen. And when I'm gone, you're going to be fasting. Word. Listen, church. Please, I'm begging you as your pastor, find time, take a break, and I'll be okay with it. If you don't, you'll be done shortly.
Amen.
Trust me. Some of you know what I mean. Amen?
Amen?
Raise your hand if you ever got tired of ministry. All right, ministry's good. Word is given by God. God's called the pastor to equip the saints for the work of the what? Ministry. Ministry is good. But it becomes bad whenever you worship it and you don't find time to rest your soul. Whenever you think you got to be at every event or you have to be here every teaching lesson or sermon, go get rest. I'm not telling you to get out of church. Amen? I'm telling you I'm going to see you a decade from now. And that's only going to take place if you get some rest. Make sense? You feel relieved? You don't got to be here all the time? Amen? You don't. I don't expect you to. I expect you to get some rest so you can be here consistently and for the long haul. Amen? It's kind of a mild sermon, right? Because I believe many folks, even in COVID, you just need to go rest your soul. Detox from social media. Detox from everything else that's a distraction. You just got to be with God and your family. Social media can cause all kinds of distractions. It can cause all kinds of bitterness and anger, and all these other things can creep in and rob your soul of joy. Go rest. Let's pray. Father, help your people to rest. Help your people to take a break. It's okay to do so. God, I pray for the families that are here every Sunday. God, I just pray they'll take a weekend off. Go spend time with their family. Get refreshed. Because, Father, they only have one family in this life. And, Father, I just pray our families would stay together. But sometimes, God, life can be too busy, work, ministry, and we neglect just spending time with our family. I know I'm guilty of it at times. And God, I just pray that we would see that it's okay to not be here and be leading. And Father, that you can still work. Father, it's not a call to just skip church every week. It's just a call to just go get some rest. Spend time with family. Father, I know it's hard for our families here to work all week and just get a Saturday, and especially if they're involved here at the church, they're back here on Sunday. God, just let our families get some rest. Only, Father, you know the families that need it tonight. God, pray that you would show them who they are so that you can prevent burnout, so that you can prevent them living in sin, so that you can prevent all the other sins that want to creep in whenever we get tired and weary. Help us to follow you. Help us to know, God, when you're saying a few more hours, but then whenever you say, go rest a while. In Jesus' name, amen.